Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the conference call to discuss Q3 and 9M FY21 results hosted by Elara Securities Private Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touch-tone phone. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Harshit Kapadia from Elara Securities Private Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Malika. Good evening, everyone. On behalf of Elara Securities, we welcome you all for the Q3 FY21 and 9-month FY21 conference call of HPL Electric and Power Limited. I take this opportunity to welcome the management of HPL Electric and Power, represented by Mr. Gautam Seth, Joint Managing Director. We will begin the call with a brief overview by the management, followed by a Q&A session. I will now hand over the call to Mr. Seth for his opening remarks. Over to you, sir.
Yes, thank you, Harshit. Good afternoon, everyone, and a very warm welcome to all of you present on the call to discuss our financial results for Q3 and 9 months of FY21. At the outset, I would like to wish everyone a Happy New Year and expect you and your loved ones are healthy and safe. After facing multiple headwinds in H1 FY21 due to the COVID-19-induced disruptions, the company witnessed a sharp recovery in third quarter. During the quarter, our overall consolidated performance in terms of revenue and profitability reached the pre-COVID level, led by robust growth in our consumer segment. This is the testimony of our strong, resilient business fundamentals, efficient marketing strategies, and enhanced dealer and retail network relationships. Discussing our segment-wise performance, the metering business witnessed a Q-on-Q revenue growth of 17%. However, the performance during the quarter remained subdued on a year-on-year basis as the inspections continued to remain low due to COVID-19-related disruptions. Revenue for the metering segment for Q3 FY21 stood at rupees 109 crores as against rupees 93 crores in Q2 FY21. We are expecting the metering segment to perform better for the fourth quarter onwards as the inspections are likely to pick up. We remain bullish on the opportunities present in the metering segment, especially in the smart meter segment, given the thrust by the SEBs and the government to install the smart meters. One-time liquidity injection of rupees 1,200 billion into power DISCOMs is likely to improve their financial positions materially. This will help support the demand for new metering orders over the next year, while also ensuring timely payment of dues to equipment suppliers like us. We are very much focused on enhancing our smart meter technological base and become the market leaders in the smart meter segment. We remain fully geared up in terms of technology and the capacity, as we are anticipating huge growth in the smart metering segment in the medium and long term. As expected, the consumer segment continued to witness strong traction. Pickup in the economic activities, coupled with various marketing and growth initiatives undertaken by the company, aided the growth. Revenue for the non-metering segment stood at rupees 135 crores as compared to rupees 107 crores in last year. The robust growth in the consumer segment was driven by healthy double-digit growth in the switchgears, lighting, and wires and cable categories, which grew by 29%, 18%, and 45% year-on-year, respectively. The revenue share of B2C segment to the overall revenue for Q3 FY21 stood at 61% as compared to 44% in Q3 FY20. Given the better working capital cycle and margins in the consumer business, the overall balance sheet strength and profitability are expected to improve with the increasing share of the consumer segment to the overall revenue. To give you an outlook, at present, we have a robust order book of rupees 354 crores. This ensures us revenue visibility for the near term. We have moved towards a leaner cost structure by rationalizing the operating expenses and the overheads. As a result, despite an increase in the raw material prices during the quarter, rationalization of overhead expenses helped the company to report an EBITDA of 34.7 crores, EBITDA margin of 14.2% in Q3 FY21, while cash PAT increased by 24% year-on-year to rupees 19.6 crores. However, as the business scenario improves, certain operating overheads are anticipated to increase on a proportionate basis. We maintained a low capex in 9 months for FY21. Further, no significant capex is currently required for future growth. Our leverage and liquidity profile continues to remain comfortable. To share an update, we have rolled out the implementation of smart street lights with centralized controlled monitoring system at Jalandhar Smart City. We have also commenced implementation of the smart meter project in Punjab. This prestigious order execution of the company will further enhance the company's performance. Looking beyond the short-term challenges, we are excited with the opportunities in the smart metering and consumer segment. We as a company remain fully geared up, both in terms of the product, technology, and capacity to leverage the opportunities that smart meters will offer going ahead. We have continued to focus on increasing our touch points and distributor base as we remain bullish on the growth trajectory of the consumer segment. Overall, the company is confident of overcoming near-term challenges and create sustainable value for shareholders. I would now request the operator to open the floor for Q&A. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Nandish Shah from Money Control Research. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for an opportunity. So my first question is whether the current EBITDA margins are sustainable going forward?
Our EBITDA margin is at 14.2%. And even last time we had said that although we are witnessing certain higher EBITDA margins, but you must realize one thing, that the current EBITDA improvement has happened mainly because of reduction of our salaries, then on other expenses, on the traveling and advertisement. So on a short-term basis, we have been able to control it, and we have seen the last two quarters having a much higher EBITDA. But nevertheless, maybe there could be a little drop as we go ahead, because proportionately certain expenses will come back as the business resumes. So currently, we are on a very low budget on advertising and even certain on the traveling and other things. So some things, as we go ahead, we may see an increase in the expenses. So the EBITDA will come down. But one more thing, I would like to say that we have also realized as a business model that there are many expenses, even overheads and others, which are not required even while the business resumes. So in a way, the internal effort is to make sure that we are able to enhance our EBITDA from the traditional levels, what we were seeing in the past 2 to 3 years. So, but on a very short term basis, maybe it may go down a little further, in the short term. But in the longer term, as the product mix improves, we will like to see it coming back to in excess of 14%.
Okay. Yeah, thanks. So my second question is, how is the dealer responses towards all your product in your consumer space? Do you expect the consumer demand to be stronger going forward?
Yes, I would say, in fact, we have been positively surprised by the response we have got from our trade and from the dealer retail network. And I would be pretty optimistic. But if you look at the last two quarters, we have seen a very steady growth in all our dealer-facing B2C segments, whether be it switchgears, lighting, or wires and cables. So even going forward from here, we are seeing the demand continue to grow, and that is there. Even internally, there has been certain re-strategizing of our approach to the market, which has also helped in the sales growing. So at least in a near term, even if you see 6 months or even 1 year, I would be quite optimistic on the consumer business going ahead and having a good double-digit growth.
Okay, thanks. Sir, and my last question is, can you, what is a bit, elaborate on the Punjab state metering orders and even the smart lightning to be provided at the generators, what is a smart city? And also, we have a similar kind of orders for any other states or the smart cities?
Yeah, so I'll independently talk on both these because both of them are independent and unrelated orders. So first is on the street lighting project what we are doing. If you recall, we had done the Bhopal smart city lighting, which was done a couple of years back, and almost a similar one, but with a little higher technology. We are currently doing the smart street lighting for the Jalandhar smart city. So that installation has commenced, and I think in the next 3 to 4 months we should be able to finish the complete installation and do that. So the main Jalandhar city today is getting a smart street lighting network. Again, that is linked to also the smart meters eventually, and that has a CCMS system which is going to have a much more smarter way of functioning for the entire street lighting system in the city. After the lockdown, we did get certain good orders on smart meters. And this Punjab state order is one of them where recently, just about, I think about week, 10 days back, the Chief Minister of Punjab has inaugurated the installation of the smart meters. So here, again, there are three-phase meters which are being installed across the state, and HPL is doing the supplies for that. So for us, it's a... both these, of course, they both coincidentally happens to be in the same state, but it's a very, these are prestigious orders, and this is something which, you know, makes our R&D proud. So if you see, post the lockdown, we have even enhanced our R&D setup, and now almost we have 200 engineers who are, you know, working on different technologies, even various communication technologies and others, which are making the products much more smarter and much more easy, you know, usable along with various technologies. So this is something what we are doing, and constantly we have been getting these projects now. So this gives us much more better pre-qualification to start doing, you know, more product, more projects, especially in the street light. Of course, the smart meter is a very big story, and we are well qualified for that.
Okay, thanks. I'm done with my questions. Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Pankaj Bobade from Axis Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks a lot for taking you mentioned about the smart metering business. Well, we have a run rate of, I suppose, 100 odd crores every quarter. And in your presentation, you have mentioned that DISCOMs would be spending around 65 to 70 odd thousand over the next 3 years. So just wanted to understand what is our and what is the current capacity utilization. Our capacity, I suppose, is 11 million. So
Pankaj, your voice is not very clear. We are missing out certain words. Can you just repeat the last part of the question?
Sure. So I wanted to understand about our the discounts would be having a deadline of converting the meters to smart meters, current conventional meters to smart meters over the next 3 to 4 years. So what is our market share, what is our current capacity utilization, and what would be the peak revenues which we would be able to get from this segment?
Yeah, sure. So if you see, you know, post the lockdown, the the business of metering and then certain smart meters, especially in uptick of the deliveries, has been a little slower. But what is very positive is that the number of tenders and inquiries what are going on right now from various central and state utilities are very high. In fact, I can personally say that if you look at the inquiry bank right now, and including the tenders which are out and under various stages of evaluation, they are almost like at an all-time high. And a lot of these tenders, even at the state level, are concerning the smart meters. So the overall industry is today moving towards a smart meter, although it will take time. So there is, the government has talked about to do that in 3 years, but I would say that will take much longer than that. Although the industry, even the domestic industry, is fully geared up and fully capable of meeting the schedules given by the government. But still, the process of evaluation and other things takes time. So the industry is moving at a very rapid speed to focus on the smart meters. As a company, we are fully geared up. We have the complete BIS licenses. In fact, last quarter, even our subsidiary, Himachal Energy, has also got independently the BIS license for the smart meter. So that makes almost two of our companies qualified for going into independently going for the smart meters. So in a way, that is moving fast. Currently, our capacity utilization in meters is about maybe 70 to 75%. But as the orders flow in, because even the finalization of the orders has been a little slow over the past 4 to 6 months. But at the stage currently where we are seeing a lot of tenders being evaluated, we expect this to pick up. Both the speed at which the order finalization will happen is also likely to go up in the coming months, and also the pickup of the material, more inspections happening, and even the deliveries, the confirmed deliveries which were deferred by the utilities. So even their pickup schedule comes within the fourth quarter, and some may be going even to the first quarter. So as an industry, we are seeing the next few months to be much better, and a pickup in this business. But again, just to repeat, the inquiry base and tenders is at a high. So as the orders will start getting finalized, there is a good likelihood that in a short time, suddenly we may see a very high flow of orders coming in. Our market share, where we have consistently over the past couple of years, where we have maintained almost 23 to 24% of the market share, I would expect we would continue, if not increase, but we would continue to be around there. And our endeavor is definitely to be a market leader in the smart metering segment.
So with 110 crores of top line this quarter from metering side and capacity utilization of 70%, would it be safe to assume that every quarter at 100% capacity utilization, we would be doing 150, 160 crores of top line from metering side? And what would be the EBITDA margins for the same?
Yeah, we are already sitting on certain ready stock, the finished product stocks right now, which is awaiting only the inspections or the dispatch clearances happening. But if you see in the past, maybe in the past 2 years, we have been doing a run rate of almost 150 crores of regular electronic meters per quarter. But if you see going forward, when we look at the smart meters, and if you just assume a full capacity, in terms of value, that will go much higher, And I think the capacity utilization, what we talk about, there are still a lot of hidden ways in which we can enhance our productions without, putting in any additional capex. So probably run certain of our productions on maybe two shifts or three shifts, or even certain non-critical items can be outsourced. So what we have done is just a very relative way of working out the capacity utilization. So in either way, when we look at a long-term growth, especially when smart meters are coming, because in terms of smart meters, the unit value goes higher. So even when we are doing the number of meters, let's say per day or per month, once the smart meters are replacing the regular meters, the value would jump up, you know, and that there will not be any constraint of any capacity coming in, at least in the near future.
What will be the EBITDA margins?
Only in the metering, or you're talking on the combined?
Yeah, metering, I mean.
We have an EBIT
margin. Currently, we are having around 14%, right?
Yes, but, you know, in the past, you know, these have been fluctuating from either 14 to even probably going up to 16, 17, depending upon the product mix. So when we see the share of the smart meters increasing, definitely we would see the EBIT margins to be on a higher side.
Okay, my next question would be on consumer durable business, if I may.
Yeah, sure.
Where do you see our company over next 3 to 4 years, given that this segment would be buzzing, and assuming that our metering segment is done, is doing well, and we would invest into the consumer durables, which is a long-term story. So where do we see ourselves in the scheme of things, in the overall scheme of things, as far as consumer durables segment is concerned?
Yeah, so if you look at because we are currently into the consumer electrical segment, and which are the switch gears, including the domestic switch gears, and then we have lighting, wires, and cables. So if you look at it, for us to go ahead for, let's say, about 3 to 4 years, we would see a good growth happening. We would also see more consumer-related electrical products coming out in the market, hopefully within this year or within the next financial year. We would see more categories being launched. So definitely we have a long-term plan for this company. As we see it, there is, smart meter is a very big opportunity. An equally big opportunity is the consumer electrical part of this. So there would be a big expansion, network expansion, which is continuously happening. We would see that going ahead in a big way. We will see more products coming in, more touch points coming into this. And also next year, we will be resuming our brand building and the advertising, but more on a smarter way. So that would be more need-based. But definitely, the kind of growth we are looking, the kind of growth to sustain those growths, definitely a lot of brand building will also be required. So we do understand that. And definitely, this will we would like to make it a strong segment for us, and also chase certain good market share in each of the categories and the combined consumer electrical segment.
So currently we are having around 150 crores of quarterly revenue, right? So 3-4 years down the line.
The non-metering is about 135 crores in the last quarter.
What's the margin there?
It depends. Like switchgear has a EBIT margin of 18%. That has been pretty constant. Of course, we have seen the commodity prices have been going up in the last 2 to 3 months. I'm sure you must have read about it. You know, the steel has gone up, copper has gone up, and also a lot of the industrial plastics have gone up. But the advantage in this segment, in the non-metering segment, has been that we have been able to pass on certain increase already to the consumer. So in the last 2 months, we have seen our selling price or the dealer list prices increase, so that we have been able to recover the added cost what has happened. So the margins remains there. The lighting is typically around 10 to 11% EBIT margin. Wire and cables is at a lesser one, maybe about 3% to 5%.
So which segment is expected to drive growth for us?
Currently, we are seeing switchgear and especially, you are talking about the trade segment?
No, I'm talking about FMEG.
Yeah, so in that, we will see the switchgear and lighting to drive a lot of our growth. And but over a period, because that's how this segment works, where the customer, or whether it's a retail or a channel network or even a dealer, they expect a complete basket of products. So to some extent, although we are pushing each of the products, but beyond a time, the the complete basket will start moving, where we will see a lot of synergies happening, where our cost can be leveraged on that. We can see a reduced cost happening and a better realization happening. So that would be the endeavor in the long term. But for the main products to drive this segment, currently will be more from the switchgear and the lighting segments.
Okay, that's all from the side. In case I have anything, I'll get back to you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. We would like to remind participants that you may press star 1 to ask a question. The next question is from the line of Atul Kothari from Progwell Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. Sir, I may have missed the starting part of the con call. So if I'm repeating the question kindly, pardon me. So what is our total manufacturing capacity when it comes to metering business?
Yeah, it's about 90 lakh meters per annum. So that's the, you can say, like an installed capacity.
Okay, 19 lakhs meters.
9 million.
Achha, 9 million. Okay.
Yes.
And so this 9 million would include both conventional as well as smart meters, right?
Yes. So this is typically in unit of meters. Now, you must realize that as the market is changing from the conventional electronic meters to the smart meters, you will see that because a lot of electronic manufacturing, even software and other things, are all flexible manufacturing. So for us, technically, we can even make 9 million smart meters in the same capacity. Only it may require certain work to be done, or rather the manufacturing process needs to be a little different. But technically, we can do that here.
Okay. And so what will be, what is our current capacity utilization?
As I said earlier, it's about 70 to 75%. Currently, yes.
Okay,
so it depends on the product mix, because we are talking about varied. Right now, if you see the manufacturing in our factory, we are currently doing a lot of single phase meters for various utilities. Then we are talking about three phase meters, trivector meters. Then there are a host of panel meters. So in total, if you see the variety of meters what we are making, will be at least 15 to 20 different meters what we are doing. So each and every meter may have certain, the time required for manufacturing, the processes may be a little different as we see that. Plus, we also have the smart meters manufacturing happening. So it may happen, and then there are certain parts of the manufacturing, because it's not a single process manufacturing. There are multiple stages of manufacturing. So some part could be working on a single shift, some on two or three shifts. So that is how we calculate the overall this. But broadly, as a ballpark figure, you can say at least 70% could be the current capacity utilization.
Okay. So, sir, it would mean that we are manufacturing close to 60 million meters. That's what right now we are basically manufacturing, right?
Yeah,
around 60
that.
Million.
Yeah.
Okay. Sir, if you can throw some light as to, in terms of the pricing between smart meter and conventional meter, what is the difference and what is the delta in margins? Margins, the delta margin between smart meter and conventional meter.
The pricing depends upon the specification of the smart meters.
Okay.
So, it's something that today when we are looking at, a couple of tenders have come out from the state utilities. Then we have the central utility coming out with that. Now, the government has come out with the specifications, or even when you see the BIS mark, what is there, the ISI mark by the Bureau of Indian Standards, which is as per the IS 16444, in that there are certain specifications what are there. So when we look at the eventually it depends on the specification what each customer picks up. But yes, the cost may go up even 1.5 times, 2 times, depending again on the specification. So it's very difficult to give just a single figure like that. The margins are definitely higher, for the simple reason that the conventional meters were just a supply of meters. Here we are talking about a software where it involves certain installation. So definitely the realization per meter is high. In fact, quite considerably higher in that. But again, if there is no single figure one can define on that.
Any range which you can provide for both conventional as well as smart meters?
It can be maybe 4,000 rupees, it can even go up to 8,000 rupees depending upon the specification. So it's just like your smartphone, exactly. You know, you can have a smartphone starting at 4,000 and even at 1,04,000, you know. So it again depends upon what you load into it, what kind of data features one would want it. But yes, if you compare with the conventional one, the realization per unit is definitely higher, and the margins also will be higher. But you must also realize that once the kind of quantities what the government is talking about, and they have been talking about 25 crore smart meters, and currently what we are seeing, the tenders which have been decided or even what are under evaluation, of course the under evaluation is now gaining much more strength, but we are still on the tip of the iceberg. So there is a lot of business which is to come by. But once those volumes are hit, definitely the standardizations will come in, and the cost will eventually, then cost will come down, and I think even the realizations will then start coming down based on that. But in either ways, the margins per unit will definitely be higher than the conventional one.
Okay. Sir, and do we provide, basically of our total order book of smart meters, how much would be conventional and how much would be smart?
Right now, a little more than one third of our pending orders of meters is smart meters.
Okay.
And I would say a good considerable tenders are also out in the market, which also represent a high volume of smart meters under evaluation. But I think in the next 1 to 2 years, we will see the smart meters share to be much higher, probably even crossing 50-70% of the entire basket.
Okay. And sir, may I know how much we have gone and we did for smart meters and conventional meters as of now? Any ballpark figure which you can provide?
No, sorry, can you repeat your question?
Sir, you have said that the tendering process is now very active. So,
yes.
So can you give me a ballpark figure as to what is the total tender or how much worth of tenders we have participated in?
No, in the in terms of, I can just give you one figure because I will not be able to break up the figure like that. But we are current talking about tenders of over 1,000 crores right now. If the total inquiry bank, including the forthcoming tenders and all, are more than 2,500 crores. But okay. If you look at the active tenders where we have participated, just if you have to ask me my estimate, it would be over 1,000 crores which we have already participated in that.
Okay, and majority of them again would be in smart meter category, right?
It's a mix. So it's very difficult to for me to just give you a figure like this. But and some things, especially on the tender front, we will like to keep it a little confidential on what tenders are coming out and what is happening. But yes, the overall, just if you need a sense of the way the industry is moving, the tenders for smart meters and even the other meters are on a high right now. But one thing I'd like to just say that in the last 3 to 4 months, the finalization rate has been a little slow for obvious reasons that, post-COVID, the utilities have been a little slow starter, but the tenders are still coming out, So eventually, and even on the pickup has been slow, but eventually, the governments, the various governments will need the meters. So we may see a stack up of orders or even a lot of tenders coming out and getting finalized, and the whole business getting stacked up. But I think that should be something very positive for us and for the industry also.
Okay. So, sir, are you planning for any CapEx? Because already we are at 75% capacity utilization. And considering
No, not at all. I think... We are past the main capex phase, so we are just about some maintenance capex. But even the way we are reviewing all the expenses, so we are also now very strict as an organization on the capex part. So in fact, We have also centralized certain things, even the decision making, just to make sure that in the various plants, whatever capex is required, that has to be purely need based, and at least for some time, we would like to run it that way, so that we are able to utilize our existing capacities to the full.
So, sir, in the event of you getting orders, because you are saying there is a huge momentum of orders which is coming in smart meter category, so how will you be able to expand or cater to the requirements which will be much more than your 90 million per annum capacity?
Yeah, so that we can do that on running the plant on various shifts. So let's say if the entire process, let's say if you have to divide it into 5 to 7 different processes happening. Today, everything is not running on 3 shifts or even some maybe not even on 2 shifts. So running it on additional shifts is something which can easily enhance our capacity. And technically, even we can go beyond the 9 million pieces if required.
And so do we also export meters? Yeah.
Sir, I would request you to rejoin the queue, sir. We have several participants waiting for the turn.
Sure, definitely. Thank you.
You want to complete your question?
Yes, sir. So my last question was, there is a government scheme which has come. I have recently read it, wherein they are planning a JV to provide common background infrastructure to all the DISCOMs. So can you throw some light as to what exactly it is? There is a JV form worth around 2,000 crores by various government-led companies.
No, I'll need to check up, but I don't have the details. But this could be something of an interesting reading for us as well. But I need to check up. So if anything, I can probably just look it up with my team and then get back to you more specifically on this.
Definitely. And sir, just one last question. From 2-3 years perspective, do you see your smart meters or your metering business revenue to at least double from here, or how is it?
Yes, we have said it earlier also. The way if you compare the business what one can do with the regular meters and the smart meters, definitely this is one opportunity. Maybe in the last, if you look at since the last decade, this is one good opportunity where the revenues can actually go much higher than the regular business what we are doing, because the government is looking at replacing all of it. So it's not only a replacement demand; it is something which normally was happening, but it is more that en masse they want to change the entire metering, and so the volumes are expected to go up. The industry is expected to grow exponentially in this. So this is, yes, one good chance. If the implementation happens in a faster pace in the next 2 to 3 years, definitely our sales can double up from here. But again, it depends upon the speed of implementation, because the implementations also requires a lot of effort by the DISCOMs. There is a lot of training involved. There is a lot of infrastructure which needs to be put at the customer end prior to the installation and the working of the smart meters. So it's a complete process, I think. But I think the process has started. Now it depends upon the speed of implementation and how it rolls out. That will determine what kind of revenues we can do. But from our point of view, whether in terms of R&D, manufacturing, supplies, we can gear up to that. Even if we have to double up from here, we can easily do that. I don't see that as a constraint.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Gautam Bafna from Wisdom Torch. Please go ahead.
Sir, our debtor number was around 440 crore as of 31st 2020, as well as September 30th 2020. What would be the current number, sir?
It's almost similar level. It's about 479. So it's almost at a similar level there.
So, sir, what is the specific reason having high debtor days? Is it because we get late payment from SEB?
Yeah, there has been the SEB payments are typically coming in about 6 months. And so that has been maintained. Of course, during the post lockdowns, in some months or sometimes certain utilities, we have seen certain delays happening. But overall, as the business is picking up in the utilities, we will also maybe see a improvement in that. While if you look at the trade business debtors are at a much lower level, but over the last couple of months, we have also seen the sales going up. Yeah, but mainly it is that. So, the bulk of the debtors are from the utilities, which are generally at 6 months.
Okay, so our borrowing level also remains, as you know, it was as on 30th September? Or
In fact, no, our borrowing has come down by almost 14 crores since the last quarter result. So from 30th mm-hmm. September, our net borrowing has come down by about 14 crores.
Okay, you know, like other electrical companies, do we also avail general financing facility?
Yes, we are doing that, and that is something which is picking up fast on a quarter-to-quarter basis. More and more dealers are getting into that, and I think that has also helped certain of our the trade debtors to come down. But as we have more and more debtor, the dealers coming in, we will see that. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that exercise post-COVID, we have even enhanced that. Initially, mm-hmm. the banks were a little slow, but now, since post-October, we have seen that part of financing also picking up here. So now, maybe next, maybe 6 months, 1 year, we will see a large part of our debtors on trade move towards channel financing here.
Okay. So, is there any possibility to, you know, get SCB finance, SCB debtors also, you know, on the same line? Financing, or you know, it can only be for trade business.
No, I think the SCB debtors. I think we have explored that. Our teams have done that, but that's not possible to have a channel financing on that. Normally, I think the banks or even other institutions are not giving it for the government procurement. More because I think the exact date of payments or other certain procedural things are there which the government normally may not comply with.
Mm-hmm. So in that case, sir, you know, as we grow significantly in, you know, coming few years because of smart meters, you know, how would we manage our working capital requirements?
No, we would see that because, you know, we expect even the trade business to grow. So it's not, of course, it's not one is funding the other, but as a ratio, even as we go ahead, I think we would probably have a 50-50 ratio going ahead. But there are other things as we look at, because in certain central utilities, especially for meters, we have seen the payments to be a little much better. So I think there are efforts going on how, because the kind of volumes the government is talking about, definitely it will have to be funded. And if it is, the government has also been, you know, specifically giving funds for smart meters, you know, with the end use being for smart meters. So probably that can also help the industry as a whole.
Okay. So as we go forward, we expect that our debtor days would improve from here.
In the trade business, yes, definitely it will improve. In the utility, it will happen depending upon you know, how the governments take it up. But right now, when the even post the lockdown, government has been talking about smart meters being on their priority. So I would assume maybe, you know, they would probably have it on their priority to pay. But still, the process is such that it will still take about 5 to 6 months of payment. So it's not, I don't see that happening in a very short payment cycle.
Sure. Thank you so much for clarifying.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Aniket Patil from AB Consultants. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Wish you a very happy new year to the team. And I have, sir, three questions. Can you share segment-wise working capital days, like the inventory, payables, and receivables? On which front have we seen an improvement in the recent quarter?
Yeah, since the last quarter, we have seen certain improvement in our net working capital. In fact, our net working capital since the last quarter is down by almost 18 crores, and even the net bank borrowing has come down by 14 crores. So although it's a small step towards improvement, but still it's a good positive step by the company. So we expect to take certain steps. You must realize that currently we are coming out from the COVID period. So there have been certain short-term borrowings, which were more of COVID loans coming in. But, you know, we have almost paid almost 90% of the short-term COVID loans. I think by 31st March, almost all the short-term loans will be paid off. So we will see definitely an improvement happening on the bank borrowing side. On the inventories, there have been certain finished good products which are almost, you know, either ready for inspection or already inspected, waiting for the dispatch instructions to come in from the utilities. The utilities have their own issues that their absorption of these meters were not happening in the domestic market or in the individual household. But things are improving. So we would see certain of these inventories also getting built out in the fourth quarter. So as that happens, even a 20-30 crore figure will make a positive step for the company. So we are just working towards that. Mm. But if you see more specifically in the last quarter, on both these fronts, we have seen a good improvement.
Great, that's good to know. My second and last question is that from your overall outlook you have shared on the call so far, we seem bullish on the consumer segment, which is maybe about 60% of the revenue. And as you also rightly said, that metering opportunity has always been there and will continue to be there, proven by the 2,000 crore worth of contracts spending. So what is the expected revenue mix going ahead? And because that will enable us to sort of describe or estimate the margin profile.
I would say this year has been a little subdued year for the metering. But next year, for first thing, we will see the metering come back to its normal level. Also, when the smart meter kicks in, that will give some kind of an exponential growth in the metering segment. But still going ahead, if we have to look at the next 2 to 3 years, we can say easily that both these segments would be almost as a 50-50% going ahead. But this is when the smart meters kicks in. On the short term, which we have been seeing from the last two quarters and maybe going ahead even in the next 1-2 quarters, we may see the consumer part to be a little more than maybe a 55 or 60% share as compared to the meters. But eventually, once the smart meters comes in a big way, the volume growth also will be high. So for us, these are two clear strategies and segments for us which can really drive the company to a different level. And that is what we hope for it. So roughly in your estimate, if I were to take it, I would still take it as a 50-50 in a, at least in a medium term basis.
So would you prefer it to be 50-50 or... you would prefer consumer segment to be higher and focus more there?
One thing, in terms of standalone margins, especially when the smart meters come, would have a very good margin, no doubt on that. The benefit with the trade businesses is that the working capital requirements are lesser. So it's of course but from a company point of view, when we look at it, we have a very wide set of customers. So if you look at HPL Electric as a company, we are today catering to the utilities. We are catering to a lot of government department, municipal corporations, institutions, industries, real estate. Then one comes into the, the domestic household, and whether it is wholesale or retail. So we are actually, the business is quite de-risk in that. So we are having a very well spread of all our customers. But in the long term, yes, for us, if you ask my preference, I would like both to grow. It's not a personal choice of what grows in this. But yes, every segment has the kind of volumes we see in meters. Probably in a trade segment, those are distributed volumes, but those kind of large orders or bulk orders are not seen generally in the trade. But yes, it has a better working capital cycle. So as a company now, we are very conscious on the working capital cycle. So over as we move ahead, we will be looking at even in the utility business, how we can work with a leaner structure for working capital and also on the expenses side. So expenses also, if you see, we have considerably been able to work on a leaner structure. And I would say going forward, we would continue to do that.
Perfect. That was great to know, sir. Wish you all the best and great 2021 ahead. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Anup Nambiat from Equity Intelligence India Private Limited. Please go ahead.
Yes, madam, sir. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. Just wanted to check on this Imagine Energy Private Limited. What would be our percentage of holding in this particular subsidiary?
Anuji, your voice is cracking.
Sir, I would request you to move to a better reception area, sir.
Just a minute.
Is it better now? Hello?
Hello? Yes, please, go ahead.
Yeah, so I was, thanks for the opportunity. I was asking about this Himachal Energy Private Limited. What would be our holding in that particular subsidiary and what is the advantages of having this license in a subsidiary rather than the parent company? And one small thing, in our presentation, it is written as a non-material subsidiary. Just was wondering why it has been described as a non-material subsidiary.
The equity, what the parent company holds in Himachal Energy is 97.72%. So practically it holds the most of the equity. Now, this was done some time back where, it gave us an opportunity to get more business having two companies quote, simultaneously quote in certain tenders. Plus, as a organization, we have sometimes, you know, like today, if you look back in our parent company and our subsidiary, it happens that we have pre-qualifications from most of the state and central utilities. We have different, like the product certifications and all happening into this thing. So in a way, we have a better opportunity of getting more orders. And I think this was done at one time, it was more relevant. But even today, when you look at even with the smart meters coming in, we would see a certain level of opportunity getting enhanced with having a subsidiary. Now, anyway, when we look at the consolidated figures, the entire figures get merged into the main company. So it does not anyway make a difference for us. Why it is called a non-material subsidiary, I think this is more of a technical term where I think based on either last year turnover, I think if it's less than 10%, you're supposed to refer it as that. But it makes no difference for us. It's you know, like a 100% owned subsidiary for the main company. And that's what it is. But that's just a technical term. So I don't think that requires any attention from anybody in that.
Got it. So any tax advantage of having a new subsidiary? Are we getting any, since this is a manufacturing activity?
No, at one time, this was set up in Himachal where there was a 10 years this excise exemption. So in the past, it has availed those benefits already. But today, those exemptions, of course, post the GST are not available. But for us, the strong part is that we have two companies which have, the pre-qualifications, and in today's time, for if you look at the metering industry, for anybody to come in and independently get the pre-qualifications is a 8 to 10 year process, you know, and we have built that up. So in the past there were certain exemptions, now they are no more valid, and and I think Himachal Energy enjoys a little lower tax of 25% as compared to the parent company, but that's that's on the income tax side.
Okay. So thanks for the clarification, Jodhanji, and wish you all the best.
Thank you.
The next question is from the line of Aditi Sawant from KIFS Investment. Please go ahead.
Hello. Thanks for the opportunity. Just one clarification here. It's AIF Investment. So my question is, in your presentation, you have mentioned about raw material prices going up. So can you throw some light which raw material prices have witnessed an increase in the prices and by how much? Also, which is what has been the trend in the prices as of today? Are you expecting any impact on the margins in this quarter as well due to that? That's it.
So if you look at, you know, the commodity prices, in fact, this is a global phenomena where we have seen the commodity prices go up. So I'll just take a few of them. If you look at, you know, copper has gone up by, I would say, almost 35% or 40% over the last couple of months. So if you see our wire pricing, although there's a the growth is there, but certain part of growth is also contributed by the commodity prices going up. So, but all these increases, whatever is happening, is getting passed on to the consumer eventually. Also, we have seen the pricing of industrial plastics go up. Now, since the last 1 month, we have seen certain, the prices stabilize. Even some items like ABS and others have, in fact, even started reducing to some extent. Steel has gone up quite a lot. So overall, if you see the broad categories of all the commodities, in the last 2 to 3 months, they have gone up. Now, as concerning the impact on HPL, in the last quarter, of course, we also, there is a lag between when the commodity prices go up and our suppliers start, you know, asking from us. And by the time we take it or consume it, there is definitely a lag. So there has been some impact in the results which are already declared, but we will see certain impact coming throughout the quarter in the fourth quarter. Now, if you look at the trade products, we have seen an increase in the switchgear pricing happening. That has already been passed on to the consumer, to our dealers and the retailers. The LED prices, as you have seen the industry trend, almost in the last 4 to 5 years, this is probably the first time we are seeing an upward trend in the LED products, in the LED pricing. Wire prices have gone up continuously over the last 4 to 5 months. So similarly, you know, wherever possible, the prices are getting passed on to the consumer. So although the cost will go up, but even the realizations are expected to go, and we would hope to probably continue to enjoy the same margin, going forward in the fourth quarter.
Okay, yeah, that was it. That's it from my side. All the best.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Devendra Pandey from DP Financial Advisory Services. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Wishing you a happy new year. And thanks for taking my question. Sir, my question is on our exports business. So what kind of growth you are seeing currently? What is the trend? And from which part of the globe are you witnessing the traction in the demand?
Yeah, you know, this year we have seen certain higher growth rates happening. So I think our growth rate in the export business in the 9 months is over 50%. But we are also sitting on certain sizable orders, order book. So overall, this year we would see a good traction in terms of sales in the export business. Although our base is still at a smaller level, so maybe this year and even the next year, we would continue to see certain higher growths happening. In terms of exports, we are in all exporting to almost 42 countries. And post the lockdown, we have seen business resume and happening in over 35 countries. This is mainly, we are covering Africa in a good manner. We are seeing, we are doing Middle East, Southeast Asia, plus the SAARC countries. So this is where we are generally focused on. But we have, the good business has come in from Africa and Middle East post the lockdown. There are still many of our customers and many of our countries and which have witnessed extended lockdowns. So that has, in fact, to some extent also affected the export business. Otherwise, we could have probably seen a much higher growth than this also. Plus, there are no exhibitions or even the travel is now totally curtailed. So that may have impacted the business to some extent. But nevertheless, under these circumstances, to have this high growth has been a very positive thing for the company.
So currently, which products are we exporting to these countries?
Mainly, these were switchgears. But in this year, we have gone beyond the switchgears. So we have seen even metering exports started, not on the utility side, but on the trade side. We have also seen wires, wire and cable, and the lighting products pick up much more. So, you know, earlier in the past 2 years, if you see, we were doing almost 90 to 95% as switchgear. This time now, although the switchgear has grown tremendously, but almost 70% is switchgear and the balance is the other product. So over a period now, we are pushing in our entire basket of products, and that will also drive the export growth going forward.
And what about the margins in this business? Is it better than the domestic one or is it lesser than that?
So the margins are, I would say, fairly good. The only thing, when one looks at the overheads and other things, the export works on a much lower overheads as compared to the local market. That is one thing. The generally, in the last 2 years, the exchange rate has also been pretty favorable if one looks at that. So that has also helped it. So the margins are decent enough. It helps us apart from, you know, it helps us also to fill up the capacities and then to, gain entry into different markets, which will in fact become much more sustaining in the long term for the company.
Okay. And my last question, sir, would be on the raw material prices. So recently you mentioned about 30-35% increase in the copper prices. Are we engaged in any hedging activities for such commodities, or do we take from the open market directly?
So we are buying from certain very reputed suppliers like the Vedanta and Hindalco. So our bulk of the purchases from there, and they do allow certain short-term hedging and holding. But these are normally, you know, so it's not, so it doesn't, you know, we don't indulge into any speculation on that. We are typically buying for our own consumption. But yes, we can have a holding of, you know, a maximum 15 days or 30 days to do that. So we do buy on dips, we do buy on averages, and but then have a consumption going ahead. So the idea is very clear that whatever trend is there, we are able to judge the strength and then pass on the same, whether it's an increase or decrease to our customers.
So were we able to pass on the entire increase to the customer?
Yes. Yeah. More or less, yes.
Okay, sir. Thanks. That's it from my side.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Pankaj Bobade from Axis Securities. Please go ahead.
Thanks again for taking my question. So, regarding the trade business, I just wanted to understand how is our presence across the country? Are we pan-India a player, or we have limited play in certain areas of the country?
So we are a pan-India player. So we have dealers, distribution, even our own offices spread across the country. So we cover every state, practically every district in the country.
Okay. And regarding the metering business, the orders would be, it would be tender based business, right? So
yes.
How is the raw material price escalation captured into it, if there is any increase or decrease? Is there any price escalation clause?
No, the government business. So if you look at our metering business, you can say almost 80% is going to the utilities, and about 15 to 20% goes in the open market. So what goes in the open market, we have a possibility of passing on the additional cost to the customer. But whereas in the utility, we are talking about fixed prices. So whether they are increasing or decreasing, it goes, you know, we go by the trend. Whatever is there, we have a fixed price, going ahead. But if you look at the metering business, copper or steel does not have so much impact on the meters. It is largely determined, of course, industrial plastic has an impact on the metering, plus then it goes into electronics and other things. So it has a little different composition as compared to the raw material prices. But whatever happens, one has to anticipate the increases, but one cannot pass on that to the, you know, you cannot change the pricing post the orders. Yeah, so government does not give any price escalation in these categories across the industry.
The line for the current participant is disconnected. Ladies and gentlemen, this was the last question for today. On behalf of Elara Securities Private Limited, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.